Hey guys, Mr. Hammer Down here, Anderson Spiegels. I wanted to come back on today and talk about one very powerful, very popular topic, the dog world. That's right, I want to deal with today, excuse me, adjust my camera. I want to deal with today the three-dimensional side of the dog world. Now, that doesn't matter if it's bird dogs, that doesn't matter if it's coyote dogs, pit bulls, whatever, the dog world. And the aspects that it makes up. Hey, y'all. Hey, I've got Sissy and Pete back here helping me. They're anchoring this thing. And my grandfather, I'll start it here. My grandfather said to me one day, he said, son, he says, job time. He said, there are three different people that make up the dog world. Come here, guys. Come here. And he says, the three different type of people. Oh, stop. Look. And there are three different type of people. They make up the dog world. They're breeders. They're buyers. Get out. You can't behave. They're breeders. They're buyers. And they're scavengers. And he says to me that you have to figure out and register somewhere in there which one you want to be. And I say, elaborate. Let me know what these three dimensions are. He says, okay, son, a breeder is a person that takes a compilation of material. They evaluate it. They make educated evaluations and observations over a period of time, a course of time, analyzing what it is that they want to possibly solicit over here to over here. And they continue to do what they feel is going to better or progress or add to that line, that stock, that so forth and so forth. I said, okay, it makes sense. He says, well, then you have the buyers. The buyers are those that once you've completed those studies, once you've carried out those strong observations and evaluations and assessments, they come and undercut you and sniff your feet out from underneath you. They're back here playing. It's my life. And, hey guys, hey, calm down, okay? And so anyway, I'm sorry about that. Excuse me. And come here, Pete. Sissy, come here. So he says those buyers, hey. He said those buyers, what they do is listen, you guys are really, yeah, my poop. They let you guys finish out. Told you this is going to be unfiltered and it's not edited. I mean, I promise you can't make this up. They are the people that watch you from afar, right? And they watch you perfect what it is you're going to perfect. And then all of a sudden they sit back, they get their pockets really high, and boom, they buy out what you worked so hard, what you put so much tedious time in. They go snatch it out from underneath you. Those are buyers. They don't really care about the sensitivity of the passion that you put into this. The years, the blood, the sweat, the tears. You guys that are beaglers, you guys know what kind of effort it takes to finish out a dog and consider it broke. Especially a male. If I took this male right here and I said, hey guys, you know what? I'm going to run this dog. I'm going to bring him on. And then he shows me some great stuff. You know, he starts, you know, really showing me those sporadic little things and whatnot. Guess what? I'm going to hold on to this male. This is my go-to dog. This is my man right here. This is my son. This is Pete. But the buyers don't care. 10,000. They suspect you're going to let that dog go. Well, the average person will. But those that are passionate, his face looks funny. Those that are passionate, they don't care about the money. This dog right here is a brutal beast. He's a big bear, teddy bear. But I tell you what, I love this dog. He loves me, him and his sister. I mean, I'm telling you, certain dogs you just can't let go. You have to say no to the buyers. These are the scum. And I'm not trying to be funny. These are the, this is the mud of the swamp. And these swamp people, you have to get them out of your circle. If you have them in your circle. These are the number one people or category of people that you have to really distance yourself from. Because if you're not careful, as my grandfather told me, the breeder in mind and aspect and approach has the proper perspective. But the buyers that only buy finished products never have any intention on finishing out their own product. Excuse me. They want to buy out somebody else's. And year after year after year, after those dogs begin to go and enter into their graying years and they start entering the decline of their rise to stardom and to greatness and to exceptionalism, now they have to buy another one. He said, son, you don't want to be those people. I said, no, it doesn't sound like I do. Excuse me. Then he says, you have a third type of person. They're called scavengers. These are those that don't have the money to buy, but they hang around like leeches or buzzards, hoping and praying that you'll throw them a scrap or you'll drop a liver or a heart, a toenail or ear, genitalia, not to be too graphic. They prey on those or deal with those, I would say prey. Prey on those that are potentially in power at one time, right? And then they sit back, hey, Pete, chill out, man, come on, dude. Then they wait to an opportune time, maybe a divorce, maybe the kennel caught on fire and you're going to go ahead and give everything else away, whatever. They're in the shadows waiting for you to make a move because they're going to make a move. Or they are those that say everything you say you're going to kill, you're going to cull, you're going to shoot, you're going to get rid of, you're going to weed out. I want it. Some of these in roosters, they call it barreling, barrel diving, dumpster diving. Where the roosters that didn't sort of make it, you hop over in there, hoping that you can pull out a nice male or something that may fit your breeding program. You can clean them up. You can heal them up. Maybe it'll work. You know, you can cornmeal his wounds, clot it up, you know, get them all cleaned up and stuff. And now you got an award-winning chicken. Well, that's a good theory. But is it one that may be able to be executed? You don't know until you try. But my grandfather told me, he said, son, which do you want to be? He said, because the ugly truth of the dog world is this. It's not going to get any better unless we start with I. The individual. I think Michael Jackson said it best. I'm starting with the man in the mirror. And I think if we are careful in our solicitation, in the passion or of the passion in which we have, we don't have to worry about another 20, 30 years of this thing constantly going down, 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 simplifying to its lowest common denominator where at some time or another is not even common. The only common thing about what's out there is our having of possession because everybody has the mediocre. Well, I can tell you this. Thurman Eugene Fryer didn't raise me to be mediocre. He didn't even raise me to be above mediocre. He raised me to be exceptional. He trained me to be exceptional. If I can't be exceptional, I'm going to die trying. I would solicit to you that you be exceptional and that you want and desire to be a breeder. Now, some people's economics and some people's economy of living warrants them to be in a different type of position where they say, hey, Mr. Anderson, hey, Mr. Hammerdown, hey, Tyson, hey, buddy, hey, boy, hey, Slick, wait one darn minute. I can't afford being a breeder because, yes, Somebody, I can hear you saying it. Don't breeders buy sometime or another? Yes, they do. Breeders make educated, I don't want to say guess, educated approaches, educated pivots in the direction of what they think could possibly land them in the field of exceptionalism. Make it plain, okay? If I've got five dogs, one is a male, four females, and I feel that one female of the four may be exactly what I'm looking for. I'm loving what this female is bringing in. She's 30, 35% on a COI of whatever it is that she is, and I want more of it. I'm gonna make the educated guess. I hate to say guess. I wanna make the educated assumption through my studies, through going and watching these dogs run, through puppies off of this line, grandpups, great-grandpups, through the dogs four, five, six, seven generations back. And I'm going to see if this is exactly what I want, and I'm going to make the educated purchase to invest in the betterment of my breeding. Therefore, in doing that, I position myself in a exceptional ward direction. Okay, I'm going to make that up. I position myself that exceptionalism becomes a whole lot more obtainable than theory. Because here we're not talking theoretically. Here we're talking about actuality. We're talking about realism. We're talking about what's there. We're talking about the physiology of that mindset to focus on exactly what it is you're trying to get. I would take the time to purchase whatever it is that I want to get, and I would implement that into my breeding program. If I had to do stud fees, if I had to buy another female, if I had to buy a daughter off of this son, or this, to that, to line breed, to keep my breeding interwoven and right here. Yes, you do have to buy at some point, but I'm talking about the breeder's mind is that concept to consistently purchase if need be in order to get to the point where the point or place of purchasing is no more, is no longer. You should get to a point where you don't have to buy or breed outside of your kennel ever again. You are right there. Now, I'm two breedings. I'm not trying to blow me up. I'm two breedings away from never. People say, oh, how can you say that? Never having to use anybody else's stud dog, never having to farm any other female out to myself or, you know, to somebody to get what I want, never having to do this and do that and trade puppies at all. The reason I'm able to say that is because I know how much time I put in this thing and I know what I'm trying to do. I know what direction I'm trying to go in. To the buyers and the scavengers, some of them are actually really good people. But then you have that side, and I don't want to put too much emphasis on that, but then you have that side that can be low. They'll talk to somebody, talk to somebody, talk to somebody, know somebody, knew somebody, knows somebody, that talked to somebody, that knew somebody, met somebody, that bought somebody a cheeseburger, that shared the cheeseburger, that ate the cheeseburger, threw this away, just to get to you. And they present to you a different face. But along the line and behind the scenes, they actually are here, but they're so in sync with this face in front that until they buy the dog and you realize that this was the person that really bought the dog, you didn't know that. And then behind this person, there's really this person. And then behind that person is really this person. And behind that person is really this person. And that person, it's a chain. This is what we call swamp people. And this is the ugly truth of this thing. Now, I won't hold you guys. I just want to go on here and talk about that just very briefly. Listen, make the collective effort to put yourself into one of the three categories. And before you hurry up and make a swift decision, make sure that you pay attention to exactly what it is that I'm talking about. So guess what? You don't become the other two. You become the first. Breed with passion, study with passion, educate with passion, cull with passion, run with passion, breed with passion, breed with passion, breed with passion. If you do that, I promise you, you will be outside of the norm. And the two-thirds that lay on the bottom, as they say, the cream rises to the top, guess what? The rest of this in there isn't cream. Somewhere in the rest of that pot, you got it. And it's at the bottom. If the cream rises to the top, what's in the rest of the pot? And if you're not careful and you stir the pot, doesn't it all gel back together? Mr. Hammerdown, Anderson's Beagles, I'll see you when I see you.
Well, hey, Perdaves.
Huh. Look at this here pedigree.
Life's rolling wheels and shifting gears round that Jersey Turnpike.
Barney hey, stopped it with critter.
His gun 10 minutes after midnight. Said, sir, you broke the limit in his rusty old truck. I don't know about that accent, son. Just where did you come from? I said, where I come from. It's cornbread and chicken where I come from. A lot of front porch sitting where I come from. Trying to make a living and working hard to get to heaven where I come from. I south of Detroit City, pulled in this country kitchen. Try their brand of barbecue, Zion said finger licking. I paid the tab and the lady asked me how'd I like my biscuit. I'll be honest with you, ma'am, it ain't like mama fixed it. Cause where I come from, it's cornbread and chicken. Where I come from, a lot of front porch picking. Where I come from, trying to make a